Welcome to Questions for Christians. I'm an atheist, and this is a show where I talk to various Christians in leadership positions, and we talk about issues and topics that have to do with theology and worldviews and religions. And these are often very emotional topics because they're strongly held emotional beliefs for a lot of us, and sometimes people in society tend to kind of freak out, argue, and get mad. And so a part of this show is to show that Christians and atheists can talk respectfully on these very important topics that we have totally different ideas about. This show is going to have five different sections. Each one's about 10 minutes. The first one section is going to be about Adam and Eve story. How should we look at that Bible story in light of modern science? The second one is, how should we interpret the Noah's Ark story in light of modern science? The third one is morality grounded in God? The fourth one is, can one feel the presence of God? Is that evidence for the existence of God? And the last one is the question, the age-old question, why is there something rather than nothing? And is that some sort of evidence for God? And then we'll do a wrap-up summary after that. To tell you a little bit about me, my name is Bernie Dehler. I'm a former evangelical, born-again Christian. I'm now an atheist. I have a bachelor's degree in electronics engineering technology, and I've been working in the computer industry since 1984. I also have a master's in ministry degree from a Baptist seminary. My guest today is Christopher Townsend. He's a leader in Christianity and has written some books. Chris, I'd like you to take a minute to tell viewers who you are for people that have never heard about you before. Maybe you can talk about your ministry, the books you've written, those kind of things.
Sure. Well, let's see. I'm a teacher at a small Bible college in Dallas, and I run a ministry as well, a teaching ministry. It's all very new, actually. I was an agnostic from about the age of 6 or 7 until I was around 26. I'm now 30, so I've only been a believer in God even, and specifically Jesus as anything more than a man for about 4.5 years, I'd say. I was baptized in January of 2011. And so I started studying the Bible after I became a believer and have just kind of gone full throttle into that thing. One of the things that was difficult for me as when I was an agnostic was seeing how people could claim to believe in an almighty creator of heaven and earth and not have that dictate everything that they did in their lives. So once I started to believe in God, that kind of became the impetus of my world. So I've been focused on those things for the past several years and am continuing to learn and study. And right now, I've just in the last 6 months or so started teaching. I wrote a couple books from what I would consider to be maybe a different perspective than a lot of Christians trend towards, specifically due to my time spent outside of Christianity and outside of the church. So coming in a little bit later in life, I think, has given me a little bit different of a perspective on some things, and so I try and share that with people. Help, you know, the one book I wrote deals with the cultural failure of Christianity, how there's problems with the interaction between culture, things like that. The second one, which is called Prove It, deals with arguments for God, more specifically how to address unbelievers. It really is more of a meta-apologetic. And then I've written a short book, which is a thesis towards my master's, dealing with church-state relations through the perspective of George Washington. So I've got a couple books I've written, writing a couple more, and I guess that's about it for right now.
Okay, and you said you're a Bible teacher at a small seminary, I think you said, Bible college.
Bible college.
What kind of courses do you teach, or have you taught?
Well, right now I teach a class called Reformational Christianity and Post-Christian Cultures, which is a course of my own making, and essentially what it deals with is the interaction between secular culture and Christianity in a post-Christian context. So as the culture at large becomes more and more secularized, mm-hmm. How has Christianity responded to that? How should we maybe respond differently, internally and externally? What's going on inside of the church, and what's going on outside of the church in those interactions? And so kind of trying to find the identity, the purpose, and the maybe some operating procedures to help Christians do a better job on a national scale of interacting and understanding the world around them.
Okay, thank you. By the way, since you're on the phone, you can't see what I'm wearing, so I wanted to tell you about a shirt I'm wearing. I just got this at the store today because Halloween's coming up. It's a Ghostbusters shirt. And one reason why I want to wear this is because I want the audience to know that me personally, I don't believe God exists. I don't believe ghosts exist. And so that includes the Holy Ghost. That includes demons and Satan and all that. And I also don't believe that supernatural things don't exist, such as heaven and hell and purgatory and limbo and all that. And just as Christians would look at the Ghostbusters movie and say, that's silly. Of course, that's not real. I would go further and say that's the same thing with everything about the Bible and all that. So I don't mean it to put people down. I mean it to put Christians down. I mean it to show I'm serious about this, because sometimes Christians think, oh, atheists really believe in God. They just don't want to admit it or something. It's like, no, I really don't believe in the existence of God. So that's why I'm wearing this. And since I took this time to say this, I'll let you respond to that how you'd like to.
Sure. Well, I would agree with you. And just because of my agnostic background, I tend to get maybe a little frustrated with some Christians when they operate under certain assumptions about people who aren't a believer. If they were raised in a Christian belief system, for example, I try and be understanding of it, but at the same time, there's an expectation and this is how it was for me, so I don't see how it couldn't be for you. So I don't have any problem with you saying that you really don't believe in God. I've been there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, when I say believe in God, too, I mean, I think people should always say a few more words. They don't believe in the existence of God, you know, just to make it clear we're talking about the existence.
Yeah. Right.
Okay, so we can move on to our first segment. This is about Adam and Eve. The reason why I chose some of these topics, like this one, for example, is because I spent 25 years as a born-again evangelical Christian, and it's like this is something they almost never talked about in church because they would say maybe it's controversial, but I always thought, why should we be afraid of learning and the truth and all that? So what I'd like to do is challenge you on this, and I'd like you to challenge me also as you see fit for 10 minutes. We can have an even exchange here.
Sure.
When it comes to the origins of humans, I think the way I see it, there's really only two choices. Either God made humans from scratch, or humans descended from other animals, whether that be theistic evolution or naturalistic evolution. But basically, it's evolution versus creation. There's descent versus made from scratch, you know, not descent. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, good enough.
So what would you, so if that was true, which end would you come down on?
Well, I'm not terribly dogmatic about it. Let me preface it with this. I'm not a scientist, so if we start getting into the nuances of evolution, I may not be able to do justice to that subject. But I have looked at some things, and I've maybe got some personal experience. I can shine some light on it. But for me, I don't think that somebody has to, and I would say you don't have to take a literal view of the Bible, specifically Genesis, to believe in God, or the God of the Bible even, and you certainly don't have to reject evolution to become a Christian. So in fact, I think Christians make a hermeneutic error when they take a literal view of the Bible, because that would require dismissing literary devices, for example, such as hyperbole, metaphor, allegory, and so on. So I think for me there's something important on the front side to say that, you know, Bernie, you and anyone else listening don't have to reject evolution to accept God of the Bible. With that said, I do tend to take to the Genesis account as a historic account, but I don't think that's a prerequisite. I believed in God and Jesus for about 2.5 years before I became a skeptic of evolution or you know, Darwinian evolution, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but
I do lean towards it being a historic account.
So do you think, are you one of those Christians that says evolution is unscientific, that there's no scientific evidence for it, and...
I wouldn't go that far. I would say that there are problems with the theory. I've looked at some of that. I'll tell you, for example, what happened with me, and you may find this story kind of funny, but so I became a believer. I'd been an agnostic and a proponent of evolution my whole life. And so then I became a believer. And, you know, my wife, for example, was, you know, raised to believe in, you know, more, I don't, like a young earth creationism, for example. And so I'm not proud of this, but even after I became a you know, follower of Christ or a Christian, whatever you want to call it, I would still kind of make fun of her for those beliefs. And, you know, I never really gave them any kind of credence just because it was against everything I had been raised to believe. So all of a sudden, I find myself attending this Bible college, and I see that I'm in this strange situation where it looks like I'm going to have to take a class on creation science. And so I'm, you know, maybe a skeptic and a contrarian by nature. So what I did was I said, well, fine, if I'm going to have to take this class, I'm going to learn everything I can about evolution and debunk this teacher and make him look like a fool. So, again, I'm not proud of my motives in these things, but so I did that, and I started to look into evolution, and I found that there were a lot of problems with the theories, and so that just started unraveling maybe some of the presuppositions that I had had about it.
Do you think you can mention what you think one of those problems are for evolution?
Yeah, sure. Well, I think there were really some ethical issues. I watched some documentaries on it, and one of the things that really stuck out to me was the recurring ethical failure of the scientific communities, where there was like this pre-commitment to evolution, and it seemed almost like a religious or a dogmatic approach. And you see over and over again where they're like trying to prove this thing. And it seems, now, it wasn't as non-emotional as I would have hoped to see. There was the historical use of bad science where it seemed like I'm watching these documentaries. And
oh, you mean like the Expelled movie?
No. You could go into that also, into kind of, you know, forcing creationists out of the conversation and stuff like that. But I mean actually the history of the development of the theory of evolution. When, you know, even before Darwin, but then Darwin and then following that, there was, you know, where there would be false models that would come up, and then people would come in and say they'd really push those models, and then they'd find out, oh, that's no good.
Okay, but I guess one thing I would ask you about, I mean, like for me, when I was a Christian, I think the first, there's two pieces of evidence that convinced me. I was a Christian, evangelical Christian for over 25 years, and
right.
I grew up as a Catholic, and as a Catholic, we kind of took the Bible kind of metaphorically, didn't really take it serious, that, you know, that's just, of course there's not a real Adam and Eve kind of thing. And then I became a born-again evangelical Christian, and, you know, I went the other extreme, kind of like you, where now I'm in this group of people, and they take Adam literally and Noah literally and all this stuff. So I tried to believe like a young earther, but didn't really get there, and I had other Christians that show me around that I went to the next level up, which is the old earth creationist. But then I saw the evidence for evolution, and I accepted evolution, and so then I was an evolutionary Christian. But for me, the reason why I had to accept evolution was primarily two arguments. One is a pseudogene argument, and the other one is the fused number two human chromosome. Are you aware of that one?
I know the pseudogenes a little bit, but no, I'm not aware of the chromosome.
Yeah, this is what this fused human chromosome number two. This was a central feature. You can look up Kenneth Miller on YouTube of the Dover trial over ID. So basically, what happens is we have one less chromosome pair than, for example, chimps and orangutans. And what happens was, if you take two, like the chimp 2A and 2B, and combine it, you can see that's one of our chromosomes. And the reason why you know that was combined is because at the end of chromosomes, there's called telomeres, and the center, there's called a centromere. And so where these two combined, we had these vestigial telomeres in the middle, and there's also a vestigial centromere. So it's kind of obvious these merged. And so therefore, it makes it obvious there's some kind of connection there with the chimps as our cousins. And to me, it doesn't make any sense to say that we were made from scratch, because why would you make from something from scratch with that, with vestigial DNA? Cool. And then the person I talked to last time, Fazel Rana, I noticed on Reasons to Believe, he wrote an article about this, and he doesn't accept evolution, but he did not deny this. He basically said, well, maybe God made humans by messing around with the existing DNA in this way. But to me, I find that unsatisfying, because it makes it look like there was descent, which I think would make God look like a deceiver. So,
sure. So, yeah, again, that would be what I was warning about on the front side, where this would be out of my expertise and something I probably couldn't do justice to in conversation.
You know,
as far as that goes. So,
I mean, to me, I see the reason why people usually reject evolution is because they just say that, well, you know, life is so complex, it's just too hard to imagine it happened. But when I see these kind of evidences, I agree that life is complex, it's amazing, the microbiology and all that is amazing, it's mind-blowing, but when you have this kind of evidence, I figure you have to accept this evidence, even though we can't understand how it happened. I mean, evolution, there's two parts of evolution. One is there's a fact that it happened, and then there's a theory that tries to explain that fact, and I see those as two different things. A theory of evolution, which is constantly being revised, there's kind of new methods and, like, for example, horizontal gene transfer is another mechanism. So there's all kinds of mechanisms besides just mutation and random mutation and descent, but natural selection. There's other things too. But and those are the things we're trying to figure out. But it seems like the fact that it actually happened, I think, is a fact. So, I mean,
right. Go ahead.
I read a little bit of your, I saw a little bit of your book on Amazon.com. I saw some of the text there, and it almost seemed like you were implying that evolution was kind of like what the atheists, you made it sound like that's what the atheists, you didn't seem very accepting of Christians that would accept evolution. But you would say that that's incorrect, that you do accept Christians that?
For starters, I don't know actually what you're referring to, where I wrote about that. I don't remember writing about that specifically. But to the question itself, I think that you can be a Christian and believe in evolution. When I look at Scripture, I find it close to, if not completely inconsistent with it when you really dig into it. But so I guess I just don't think that you need to presuppose, but like you cannot accept Christ without rejecting evolution is what I'm kind of saying on that.
Yeah. Well, I guess, I would say that's why I left the faith, is because I saw the fact of evolution. But like you said, if you look at Genesis, I think it's obvious it was written as a historical account because it's given genealogies. You wouldn't, if Adam is a figurative person, you wouldn't put him in a genealogy. So it's obviously these people thought he was a historical person. And personally, I just thought the two cannot be reconciled, and so I thought it made more sense to leave the faith over that. I mean, that was one of the reasons.
Yeah, see, that's, there's just so much. When you start looking back, like you talked about, there's facts, there's things we can look at and observe, but when you start going into the process of distinguishing those things, it gets pretty fuzzy, and that's where I really started to have a problem with some of the ethics that I saw being used in the scientific field. And I would include now, I was speaking specifically before about the historic development. I mean, so I'll give you an example. I'm watching this documentary, and there were a couple things that really stood out to me. One was there was this underlying religious tone to it, even though it was a secular documentary about evolution. You know, where the cover of the documentary was the Michelangelo, where Adam and God are reaching towards one another, and they had replaced God with an ape. And I'm like, why would you even why is that necessary? Why are you making a religious statement in a scientific documentary? But then there were other things where, like, so they go through the whole lineage or the whole history of the development of evolutionary theory, and they keep talking about Neanderthals, and they even go so far as to show, I would call this almost social engineering, but they go so far as to show these really intricate narratives where they have these Neanderthals interacting with humans, and then they say the humans came in and wiped out the Neanderthals. And then at the very end of the documentary, they say that, I think it was a German geneticist determined that Neanderthals couldn't have even been in the same lineage as humans because of the genetic differentiation.
Yeah, well, from my understanding, they say there was some mixing with Neanderthals. It was like 5% or so. I think Fazel Rana, who I talked to last time, he doesn't accept evolution, but he accepts there was some mixing there, I'm pretty sure.
I don't remember him saying that. That may be true, though. But anyway, so my point is that there's a lot of the things that are presented as a unified front. When you really start digging into it, you find out that there's not nearly as much synergy, maybe, as you would expect to find within some of those evolutionary theories.
But, you know, I guess one problem I have with what you're saying, though, is when it comes down to evolution, is it true or not? It comes down to what is the evidence for it? And it sounds like when you're saying you don't accept evolution because of the social issues, that's not looking at the facts of it. That's looking at the consequences of it. And you
I have looked at the evidence. But again, what happens is you've got some really high level skilled scientists on both sides of the argument who are interpreting the data through different lenses. And you can go back and forth into eternity, and I think that's ultimately a healthy process because it, to some degree, keeps everyone honest and challenges their ways of thinking. But I'm not particularly a scientist in that. Like, on my list of things that I'm particularly that I care about on a high level, whether or not, you know, macroevolution, whether or not there's species jumps and things like that, or massive mutations within a DNA structure, that doesn't influence so much how I'm going to live out my life and how I'm going to influence people. So I just let other people handle that right now, and I look into it. Mm. Maybe it's a hobby to look into those things, but it's not something I'm going to spend my life researching every new paper that comes out. I'm just going to put that one on the back burner because, like I said, to me, really, even I would suggest that having you and I having this conversation about interpretation of Genesis is out of place in a sense. It's kind of putting the cart before the horse. I would look at that as more of an internal apologetic conversation where, you know, Christians who do believe in the authenticity of the Bible or maybe the reliability of the Bible can speak to one another and say, well, this is how I interpret it. This is how I interpret it. But the fact that there are so many Christians you've got a lot of Christians who are young earth, a lot of, you know, you've got the reasons to believe guys, you know, who are old earth, but not evolution. Then you've got the evolutionary Christians. So you've got this wide breadth of interpretation and everyone has their own way of interpreting the scriptures through the science. And to me, it's just, you know, you're going to end up coming back to, well, ultimately we don't have the final answer, but we can kind of guess around at it and get some really good ideas. But I've seen successful arguments on all ends, and it's just not where I've... Yeah, I mean, like I said, I've only started looking into these things in the last 4 years, so I have to kind of, pick and choose what I'm going to really pour my heart into, and so I'm more interested in things like ethics and how to function as a culture and a community.
Right, right.
Not necessarily. And I'm not knocking the science. It's super important. I just personally haven't gotten into a very high level of it. And it's not going to, if I was to turn around tomorrow and say, I believe in evolution, that's not going to change the way I live my life so much.
Actually, it could. I mean, for me, that's the reason why I left the faith. I mean, if you were to accept evolution, you may come to the conclusion like I did that Genesis, that all that is a myth, and then you have to reinvent it, and then once you go down the path of evolution and how the stars were formed through cosmic evolution, I mean, it's kind of a snowball effect. It would I guess, you know, in technical terms or academic terms, it's, you know, your hermeneutics. It would affect your hermeneutics on how you see everything in the Bible. But you're...
Yeah, but there's other, there are other things. My only evidence isn't whether or not I have, I'm not going to reject the Bible because of one interpretation of the Genesis account, is what I'm saying. So even if I found out that macroevolution was 100% mm-hmm. true, it's not going to change whether or not I believe the entirety of the Bible is reliable. It would just change maybe how I would interpret Genesis 1.
Well, for me, it was about half of it. The other half was neurology, which we don't have on our agenda today. But I wanted to mention, too, you said, like, there's experts on all that disagree about this. But from my perspective, if you look at, you know, every state has, like in Oregon here, we have two public universities. We have the University of Oregon and Oregon State University. So some states have more than one public university. And as I understand it, every single state university teaches evolution in science, you know, for the origins of humans, et cetera. And not one of them would teach creation science. And so I think it's untrue to say that, well, there's people in science who disagree, you know, both sides. I don't think that's a true statement when you look at practicing biological scientists. I mean,
I would actually take that the other way, and I would say that what you're looking at is would be a bent away from true science, because you're not allowed to really get into creationism in those environments. It's what we're doing is I look at indoctrination as a given. We're going to get indoctrinated one way or another, and so the school system right now is perpetuating an evolutionary perspective. And so
why is that?
I would call it a political thing. I mean,
where we would disagree. I think it's because of the science. But
well, I know some really skilled doctors. I know mm-hmm. pilots. I know physicists. I know cosmologists, biologists who believe in creation. A non-evolutionary perspective of creation.
But you know,
if they're a doctor, just fine.
But if they're a doctor, it wouldn't matter. I mean, doctors aren't experts in. They're not PhDs. I mean, if you said you had people with PhDs in biology that rejected evolution, that would mean something. But mentioning pilots and doctors and other lawyers and stuff.
You don't think there's any PhD biologists that reject evolution?
There are some, but I would probably say it's less than 1%. It's probably like half of a percent or something. It's very small. It's insignificant.
That's probably true, but the system is not set up to allow for any dissent, no pun intended.
Okay. All right, shall we go on to the next one?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, let's talk about Noah's Ark. I think this is an interesting topic because, like I said earlier, that I was kind of frustrated as a Christian. They don't really want to talk about this in church because it seems like it's divisive. But it's like, why are you afraid to explain this? The way I understand it, there's three major categories. One, the young earth creationists will say basically that there was a worldwide flood about 6,000 years ago that destroyed all land-based creatures except for those saved on an ark, which is 8 humans and some of the animals on there. Then the next branch would say, like, well, no, there is actually a local flood. This is the old earth creationists. There's a local flood. It was a local area. Wiped out all humans. They're all local there. So therefore, you don't need to see evidence in the world, you know, for a worldwide flood. And then the third category is actually Christians. You'd say, of course, it's a myth. It's not meant to, you know, it's basically meant to teach you some kind of spiritual truth. It's not meant to be a historical story. Do you agree with those camps, or would you put yourself in a different camp?
No, I think that's fair.
And then, of course, Christians always mix and match. I mean, I'm saying those are like three coagulated kind of positions people can go into, but people always mix and match. But.
Right, yeah, always a sliding scale on these things. So, I'd agree with those three classifications as a general starting point.
And so how would you come down on that?
Again, not my area of expertise. I would say that I that you don't have to accept the flood narrative as a historical event in order to believe in God or the God of the Bible. I think it's unquestionably allegorical. So the only question that remains is, was it historical, and if so, to what capacity? And I lean strongly towards it being historical and a little less strongly towards it being a global flood. Again, these are things, I do reading to kind of land on my conclusion on them. As far as being able to rearticulate the nuances of the arguments, not my strength, but I mean, I can speak to the allegorical nature pretty clearly, and then I know of some evidences for it being a historic event, and certainly, or a historical event, and then, you know, even some evidence of it being a worldwide flood, or a global flood, I think is the terminology that young earth creationists would use.
Mm-hmm. So you're tending to believe that it was not a worldwide flood, that it was a local area?
No, I would say, if I had to, you know, take a guess, I would say global. But again, I don't lean terribly strongly on that. I'm not going to, you know, call someone a heretic if they say that it was a local flood, or even if someone said it was allegorical. I would lean towards saying that's incorrect, but again, I could be wrong on that. But I think that, I mean, the allegorical nature of it's unquestionable. And so at the very least, you have that where it, you know, works as an analogy for God's salvation and so on and so forth. And it's pretty intricate how the allegory plays out.
I'm kind of interested in your statement that you said that you're not an expert in it. So this is your opinion kind of thing. But it's like, do you really need to be an expert in this to know this kind of story? I mean, you teach at a Bible college and you write some books on apologetics. I would think that you should have an informed opinion on this.
Well, it's informed, but I mean, you understand the depth to which these arguments can go. It's never ending, you know, and it's all postulation. Ultimately, it's shots in the dark. How do you interpret this data versus how do you interpret that data?
Well, I think the biggest problem with the global flood idea is that that would leave a mark on the world, a tremendous mark, and there is no mark. And somebody like Ken Ham, who says, like, well, what would you expect from a global flood? You know, fossils laid in mud, and that's what we see. You know, it's like, that seems like a really naive view of fossils.
In what sense?
Well, for example, considering the fossils, what kind of fossils you have, where they're at, they're like certain fossils in certain geographies, which go along really well with the idea of evolution. Maybe a bigger idea is that they're sorted in order of complexity. I mean, you know, it's kind of a joke that, well, there was a worldwide flood, but the waters were smart enough to sort them out according to complexity. You put the least complex at the bottom and the more complex at the top, like evolution says. I mean, and then just to think, like, you know, there'd be fresh water, and this is what a lot of people say is, like, it's kind of silly to think that there's fresh water and the salt water mixing up everything. You know, if it was all ocean water, there's freshwater fish that could not survive in salt water, and I think vice versa. And then just to think, oh yeah, you know, the polar bears have to get to the ark, and the penguins have to get to the ark, and then they have to get back to where they went. The kangaroos and all that, all these animals that you find on different continents had to get to the ark and then back to where they were going. It just seems kind of ridiculous.
Well, see, and so that's why I said what I said, as far as the nuances of this stuff are never ending. You know, you can always come up with, well, what about this? What about this? What about this? And there are people who make a career out of answering those questions. That's just not the area I've chosen in my short time as a Christian to focus.
Yeah. Well, you know,
I've looked into them, but as far as being able to sit here and, you know, you come up with a million, or not a million, you know, but constant, like, well, what about this? What about this? What about this? I'm just not the person that you should be talking to about that particular question, but I can point you in a direction of people who can.
Well, who would you point me to for that?
Well, I mean, like you said, you know, if you want to look at a young earth, the evidence for the young earth, I'd probably point you towards the Hovines or the Hams of the world. And if you wanted to look at maybe the localized flood, I'd point you more in the direction of the Rosses and gentlemen like that.
You know, one thing that was weird, I'll tell you, I went to this meeting where there's these professionals, and it's called the American Scientific Affiliation, ASA group, and they're basically a group of Christians who have advanced degrees, usually at least a bachelor's degree, and a lot of them are like seminary professors. Some of them are in science and some of them are in theology. And one of these guys came to, while I was a Christian, he came to this school and gave a talk, basically introduced the group. And I asked a question. I said, what do you think about the flood? Was it local or global? Because I really wanted to learn. And he basically dodged and said, well, some believe this, some believe that. And so I was kind of disappointed he didn't really say the answer. And he kind of said, oh, there's somebody else in the room here that could, you know, tell you some more. So then I talked to the guy at the end, at the end of the room, and he's like, well, of course it was, you know, it's a myth, you know. And so that was kind of interesting. So like when somebody asks you, you know, how do you interpret this? And you say, well, here's these different opinions. That's what I found kind of frustrating, I guess, because they're not really providing any answers. It's just saying, go look in these different positions. But
well, but like Bernie, if you really wanted to search out those answers, and I mean, I'm saying in a different context, maybe like if you were someone who was really seeking these answers, and if I was acting in a pastoral capacity, what I would do is I'd say, you know, what are your specific questions? I might not have all those answers right now, but you know what? Why don't we go find those together, and we can look at the different things. And I've done that for people, not on this specific issue. But, you know, someone came to me and they were questioning about the Apocrypha, for example. And I didn't have a ton of information on that. Again, it was something that I had researched enough to get my own piece on, but I wasn't ready to rearticulate the arguments to someone. Mm-hmm. And so I went and I spent, I don't know, probably 20 hours with them, just going through bit by bit, saying, okay, now, how, you know, here's the evidence for this, here's the evidence against it. Let's look at experts on both sides of the field and come to some kind of a reasonable conclusion together. Okay. So I would say that I'd agree with you. It's a shame that that's the way it was left for you. I don't think they're wrong to just say, hey, here's the different views and there's more information available. But I personally would take it a step further, whereas if you're really trying to seek that information, and I'm going to make myself as available as possible to get you some resources or even walk through it with you hand in hand. So well, I think that's more of a pastoral failure than maybe a scientific failure.
Well, I think the person that I asked that, I think he actually had a position and thought it was, a myth, but he didn't. But he was playing political and didn't want to, you know, hurt any feelings or take a position, especially since he's speaking to a crowded group because he's trying to appeal to everybody. Their organization has young earth and old earthers and, you know, evolutionary creationists in it. So he was just trying to give a political answer. So
right.
Okay. So,
again, for me, these just aren't huge game changers for me, because I think you can reasonably read the Bible and get it just as allegorical. And now I think there is also, there is a case for the historic usage of it, and so I think there's something to be said for that. Mm-hmm. But I don't think you have to, if it wasn't a historic event. And you can go into the evidences. You know, I saw a clip the other day about that they're exploring the structure on Mount Ararat. They've dated the wood at 4,800 years. It's a multi-level massive structure that they're actually going inside of. And, you know, is it the Ark? I don't know. You know, time will tell. If it is, well, that would say that at least something happened there. That wouldn't prove a global flood, but, you know, that would be at least a local, and maybe it's not it. But that doesn't mean, again, that's not a disproof necessarily. So,
yeah, that would be good to look into facts like that, because sometimes you find people are actually lying. I mean, like, for example, one time,
who the source was for this one, and these aren't the type of people that would be lying.
Well, one time I was at a debate and somebody asked me about, what about life after death? And, you know, there's people who have died and went to hell or heaven. And it's like, yeah, well, and there's this one kid they wrote a story about who went, I think it was, I can't remember if it was heaven or hell. And later on the kid admitted it was all a sham.
Right.
But, you know, here's the book in the Christian bookstores.
You've got a lot of Christians who will tell you that would be unscriptural to say that too.
Yeah. Okay, so we go on to the next topic.
Yeah, sure, that works for me.
Sounds like this might be your favorite one, morality.
Yeah, this is, again, not an expert yet, but this is something I've spent more time focused on a personal level. And
okay.
It had a deeper impact on me personally growing up.
Well, maybe we can take about 5 minutes each on this. One thing I wanted to ask you about was in debates on morality, Christians will say that atheists have no basis for morality and that they're just stealing from the Christian worldview, which I think is totally silly. I believe that the basis that morality is all about behavior, good and bad, and good behavior helps the community and bad behavior is what hurts it. And that's why we say don't kill, and that's why we say it's good to feed the poor, for example. You don't know if you're going to be poor or not, so it's nice when you look out. So it's kind of a no-brainer. You don't need God for that. One thing I find is interesting is that I think to say that God is the basis for morality, there is some really gross immorality in the Bible prescribed by God, some of his commands. And one of them is, I showed you on Twitter the other day about Numbers 5, about induced abortion, how the priest can do an abortion. How about if I read the passage on that and talk about this for a few minutes, and then you can tell me what you would like to talk about from your position.
Sure.
Okay, so I'll read this. Numbers 5. It's called the test for an unfaithful wife. So if you're a Hebrew and you believe that your wife is unfaithful, but you don't have proof for it, this is Numbers 5. It says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, if a man's wife goes astray and is unfaithful to him, so that another man has sexual relations with her, and this is hidden from her husband, and her impurity is undetected, since there's no witness against her and she has not been caught in the act, and if feelings of jealousy come over her husband and he suspects his wife and she is impure, or if he is jealous and suspects her even though she is not impure, then he is to take his wife to the priest. He must take an offering of a tenth of an ephah of barley flour on her behalf. He must not pour olive oil on it or put incense on it, because it's a grain offering for jealousy, a reminder offering to draw attention to wrongdoing. The priest shall bring her and have her stand before the Lord. Then he shall take some holy water in a clay jar and put some dust from the tabernacle floor into the water. After the priest has had the woman stand before the Lord, he shall loosen her hair and place in her hands the reminder offering, the grain offering for jealousy, while he himself holds the bitter water that brings a curse. Then the priest shall put the woman under oath and say to her, if no man has had sexual relations with you and you have not gone astray and become impure while married to your husband, may this bitter water that brings a curse not harm you. But if you have gone astray while married to your husband and you have made yourself impure by having sexual relations with a man other than your husband, here the priest is to put the woman under this curse. Quote, may the Lord cause you to become a curse among your people when he makes your womb miscarry and your abdomen swell. May this water that brings a curse enter your body so that the abdomen swells or your womb miscarries," end quote. Then the woman is to say, amen, so be it. The priest is to write these curses on a scroll and then wash them off into the bitter water. He shall make the woman drink the bitter water that brings a curse, and this water that brings a curse and causes bitter suffering will enter her. The priest is to take from her hands a grain offering for jealousy, wave it before the Lord, and bring it to the altar. The priest is then to take a handful of the grain offering as a memorial offering and burn it on the altar. And after that, he is to have the woman drink the water. If she has made herself impure and been unfaithful to her husband, this will be the result. When she is made to drink the water that brings a curse and causes bitter suffering, it will enter her, her abdomen will swell, and her womb will miscarry, and she will become a curse. If, however, the woman has not made herself impure, but is clean, she will be cleared of guilt and be able to have children. This then is the law of jealousy, when a woman goes astray and makes herself impure while married to her husband, or when feelings of jealousy come over a man because he suspects his wife. The priest is to have her stand before the Lord and to apply this entire law to her. The husband will be innocent of any wrongdoing, but the woman will bear the consequences of her sin. So, I mean, the weird thing there is that a lot of Christians, especially Catholics, who are the biggest denomination by far of Christians, would say that, you know, abortion is sinful under any circumstance. And here the priest is actually, seems like the priest is actually doing it in the case of a guy suspecting his wife. You know, basically it's called the test for an unfaithful wife if the husband is jealous. So what do you think about that?
Well, I think there's a lot of things. For one, again, you could spend a lifetime just going through each and every thing in the Old Testament. But as to this specific one, you're reading out of a very specific interpretation or translation, as it were, of that scripture, which uses the word miscarry, which is not used in other versions. And it's also, there's no other mention, other than the word miscarry, there's no mention of her being pregnant. So jumping into that being an abortion is, to me, a bit of a stretch to claim that.
So are you saying, are you saying that's a bad translation? There should be a better way to translate it?
I would say so, yes.
So what would be a better way to translate it?
Well, I'm not a translator, so I'd have to go back in, but that's the general, when I went through and started looking at that to answer your question, that was the general consensus, was that was one specific translation in the 2011 NIV, mm-hmm. but that the rest of them aren't, there's maybe like one other one that translated it that way. So, but in any case, I think that's really looking at one very specific thing and ultimately missing the point of the claim that atheists are cherry-picking Christian morality. So, I mean, you can go through. I will submit to you that there are lots of stomach-churning things in the Old Testament that seem contrary to our current ethics, and I think there's probably a reason for that. But as to your broader question, I think there's maybe some other things we can talk about, because I would agree that ultimately atheists are borrowing from a Christian perspective, both historically and philosophically.
Well, we can talk about that from atheists. I'll give you, some time to talk about that, but I wanted to explore some things on this. One thing is the NIV, the NIV says, it talks about miscarriage, and here it says to, what is the NIV? And it was a big translation thing. There was 15 Bible scholars using Hebrew, Aramaic, Greek text, whose goal was to produce a more modern English version text than the King James Version. And so they try to use more modern language. And if you look at the other versions,
it's also
for
not a word-for-word translation. It's a thought-for-thought translation. Well, like, not necessarily even getting the original. I mean, you're trying to translate it into English out of the Hebrew, and they're not. Mm-hmm. It's not going word for word.
Right, right. Yeah, that's what I want to say. Like, for example, the New Revised Standard Version. It says on verse 22, it says, "Now may this water that brings a curse enter your bowels and make your womb discharge, your uterus drop, and the woman shall say, Amen." There's another translation called God's Word, and this one says, "May your stomach swell and your uterus drop." And I thought, what does uterus drop mean? And so I looked on the internet, and what happens is, this is actually kind of a rare case, but it happens frequently for a rare case, I guess, is that a woman's uterus can actually fall out because there's muscles holding it in, and they're weak. And they say now there's a surgery where you can tack it up again. So this is saying basically the uterus is going to fall out. And then how do those...
mean that she was pregnant.
Well, if her husband suspects she was fooling around, and this curse goes through, if she was impregnated, that's only going to be abortion right there.
If she was,
yeah.
If
she was, there's
a presupposition that she was pregnant.
Yeah, but the whole point though is that she was fooling around, they think. Well, the other thing I wanted to say too is that all these other translations, they all talk about thigh. They say, instead of like your uterus drop, it'll say your thigh to rot, your thigh to rot. Well, what can thigh to rot mean? And they say this basically is kind of a euphemism, this thigh. I mean, sometimes in the Bible it's translated as loins.
Right, so...
So yeah. Basically it just means the reproductive areas or the sensitive areas. I mean, you don't think a woman's thigh is really going to rot. I mean... That doesn't make any sense to say her thigh. Which thigh? I mean, the right thigh?
Some kind of damage to the reproductive area. Yeah.
Yeah.
Whether or not there's a baby involved would be a separate issue, I would suggest. But
so, and the other thing about this verse, too, it just kind of shows to me like there's magical thinking going on, like we're going to give this potion. I mean, of course, Jewish people wouldn't do this. Nobody would do this today. And you might say that was a special time. Back then, God did miracles, but... It just seems like this is kind of showing the magical thinking to me that the Bible is rife with.
Yeah, I mean, we could go on for a long time, you know, dissecting every verse. If you had told me you wanted to discuss that specific verse, I would have done more research on that. Again, you know, there's, you can cherry pick any verse in the Bible and say, well, explain this and explain this and explain this. And, you know, there's answers available for those things, but I'm not an encyclopedia where I can go in and say, oh, well, this is, you know, this is what the original Hebrew meant just off the top of my head. So I'd have to go and actually look at that.
Well, I'll tell you, I went on BibleGateway.com and I looked at some of the commentaries on there. They had quite a few. And I looked on verse 22 specifically about the miscarriage. And it's kind of funny because a lot of them had comments about it, but they had comments on verse 22. They were explaining the last part where it says, amen, amen. It's like, are you kidding me? You're explaining amen, but not the main point of that sentence? So I just thought that was kind of funny. But unless you have more to say about that, you can bring up, now what would you like to say about morality for me?
Well, so I just, because when I was an atheist or an agnostic, as it were, atheism seemed like a pretty bold claim, but I was an agnostic and a strong agnostic. I had ethical issues. So I thought maybe you're familiar with Will Provine.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, because I think he takes a very, I appreciate his perspective. What his perspective was, he's passed away now, but I think his perspective is pretty honest about things. He said,
"Yeah, he was in the he was in the Expelled movie."
Was he?
Yeah, that's
okay. Yeah, he may have been in that. That makes sense. Right, but he's an atheist.
Yeah, they tried to make him look really bad in that movie. Yeah.
Sure. Well, his statement, I think, though, is really honest, and I appreciate that. He says, let me summarize my views of what modern evolutionary biology tells us loud and clear. There's no gods, no purposes, no goal-directed forces of any kind. There's no life after death. When I die, I'm absolutely certain that I'm going to be dead. That's the end for me. There's no ultimate foundation for ethics, no ultimate meaning to life, and no free will for humans either. So I think he strikes on some things, and so to me, there's a lot of problems with trying to develop an ethic without God, and there's a lot of evidence for that. But I would just ask you, it seems to me, Bernie, when I hear you talk about ethics, that you presuppose some things. So for one, I'd ask you, where do you, what gives you the right to ascribe value or worth to humans? Because that's inherent in your claim, right?
Is that, well, like I said at the very beginning, morality is... See, like, math is all about numbers. Morality is all about behavior. It's that simple. As math is to numbers, morality is to behavior. So then you say, what is your good behavior and what is bad behavior? Good behavior is stuff that's good for society, and bad behavior is stuff that harms the society. So that's the big picture.
But you can't say that.
Why not?
Where do you, how do you, it's begging the question. Like, how is it that you're defining morality, like, from, you're going backwards. How is it that humans have value and worth? How is it that society is what is good? Like, protecting society is what is good. Where do you get that from?
Well, when I say, let me take it one step at a time. When I say morality is all about behavior, do you think there's a problem with that statement?
No, I agree.
Okay, so that's self-evident. And then if I say good behavior is what's good for society and bad behavior is what hurts a society, you're having a problem with that statement?
Absolutely.
That's like, it's obvious
because
you know, if you look like Maslow's pyramid, you know, there's everybody at the very bottom, you need to get security, you need to get food, you need to get shelter. And then as you go up, you get more and more actuated.
But you're presupposing humans as the ultimate thing to be protected.
It depends. I mean, morality could be expanded to taking care of the animals and the earth and everything else.
Well, what if I tell you that I think that humans are a parasite or a plague, and that creation itself is what should be protected, so I should wipe out all of humanity? What would stop me from doing that ethically?
What would stop you? Well,
I mean, ethically, what's wrong with that?
Well, let me give you a similar experiment saying. Like Sam Harris talked about this. You know, he talked about morality, and he says, like, you know, some people say, like, well, how do you know? Similar to the question you gave, and he goes, well, look at health. We want to have good health. And what would you say to somebody who said, like, well, I believe that we should be just. I don't believe that we should all. I don't think good health is about, you know, being well fed and feeling good. I think good health is about throwing up every day and having pain in your back and sores on your feet. I think that's what good health is. I mean, if health is about being healthy, why? I don't understand why it's complicated that if you want to have a good society, that's what morality is. That's what I don't understand why that's controversial. That has nothing to do with God. So I'm not really sure why.
Because who says that society is a thing that should be protected? Ethics are a form of protecting something, right? Or promoting something. And ethics, what you're saying is the ultimate thing to be protected and promoted is society.
No, I'm saying ethics are about behavior. And when you talk about behavior, behavior is for the society, correct?
But you're talking about the consequences of behavior, and the thing that that you're trying to protect from or promote through certain behaviors is society. And I'm telling you that you've made a big leap there in assuming that society is that thing that should be protected and promoted mm-hmm. through behavior.
Well, like I said, but math is about numbers. And you could say, like, well, why does math have to be about numbers? Maybe it should be about letters. Well, math is just defined about numbers. It's dealing with numbers. That's what morality is. It's dealing with behavior, and good behavior is what's good for the community. That's why... We all know this, and that's why if somebody came to you and said, you know what, God spoke to me. He said he wants me to rape that woman over there. You can't say, like, oh, well, whatever God told you is fine. You got to say, no, that's wrong. Why? Because you know that's bad for society if people went around doing that.
But where do you get philosophically, where do you gain access to the right to say that society is the ultimate thing that should be protected?
Like I said, that's like saying, why do you say math is about numbers? It's just
I don't think
just,
it is.
It's just by definition.
What is to say that, like, why would humans be more worthy of being protected than the creation itself? I mean, there's a lot of people that are leaning towards that direction. You talk about people who are, you know, wanting to reduce population and such like that
right.
because it's bad for the environment.
Right.
So
right.
what is ethically wrong with me wiping out 90% of humanity for the sake of the world?
You know, it's like in an airplane. When the airbag drops, they say, take care of yourself first, and then your passenger, your child, or something. That's the way the earth is. We are the stewards of this earth because we are the most intelligent. We are the apex predator here. We are in control of everything. If we don't control ourselves, we will destroy the earth. We're on a spaceship earth. We need to take care of this like a hamster cage. If we just wreck it, it's bad for everything. So we need to take care of ourselves and other species.
But again, if we just
kill ourselves,
reason to, why should we protect it? Let's just look at one human life even. Why is that one human life worth protecting?
Well, because like for society, based on reciprocity and things like that, you want to help other lives because you would like them to help you.
Why?
If you help other lives when they need help, reciprocity means they would also help you when you need help. This is society helping each other.
But why? Why should we help each other? To what end? What's the value in it? What's the worth of it?
To have a thriving society. It's that simple.
Why? Why should we have a thriving society?
Because everybody wants to live in peace. They want to be satisfied. They want to be well fed. They want to be entertained. Those are all good things. They want to feel fulfilled.
You're begging a lot of questions here, but we can move on from that question because it doesn't sound like you're really, I mean, you're just saying that it's self-evident is essentially your answer. It's self-evident that humans are the most valuable and worthy thing to be protected in creation.
Well, the reason,
I said
we had to put ourselves first, like the woman in the airplane with the airbag, because we are the apex people in charge here.
Does that matter, though? I mean, we're killing all these other animals. We're destroying the earth.
If I'm
taking an evolutionary perspective on things, an atheistic evolutionary perspective, I'm looking at humans as a parasite that need to be exterminated for the sake of the rest of creation. And I don't think without some kind of transcendent determinant, you can say that that's incorrect.
Well,
you can, unless you're predefining morality as that which, you know, whatever you said, promotes society. If you're saying what is ultimately foundationally right and wrong, it's circular reasoning what you're saying. You're saying what's ultimately right and wrong is promoting society because what's ultimately right and wrong is promoting society.
No. I'm saying morality is about your behavior and your behavior going to society. Okay, so let's say somebody else says, hey, I believe morality is all about, I'm not sure, what's the goal if they want to kill all the humans? What's their morality about? The earth, maybe?
Sure.
Okay, so somebody else says my morality is about treating the earth as number one, and humans are a threat to that, so we should wipe out all humans. So it's okay.
Right.
Okay, that's fine. That's your definition of morality. This is my definition of morality. Let's discuss it and see who has a better definition of morality. That stuff kind of works out. The problem, though, when you get into religion, is you get Christians saying that morality comes from God. There's a moral philosophy called divine command theory where God said it and therefore it's right. You don't think about it. God just gives these commands.
I agree with divine command theory on an ethical foundational level. Now, when you're talking about political theory and the application of that foundational ethic or that philosophical ethic, that's a different issue. But as far as because morality assumes the fact that a behavior can be right or wrong, it assumes that something is of value,
right.
Just utilitarian use.
The value is
some kind of transcendent value.
No, not transcendent. The value is just in society. I mean, like I said, math is about numbers and morality is about behavior, and the behavior is in regards to society. So if you want to say morality is something else like saving planet Earth, that's a disagreement we can have.
Right, but and then who's to say who's right, though, is what I'm saying. How do you know who's right in the end? I mean, you don't believe that we're both right, do you?
No. That's like saying if one person says math is about numbers and somebody else says, no, I think it should be about the way you dress, discuss it and see which way it makes more sense.
Well, yeah, that's fine. But what I'm getting at is one of them is correct and one of them is incorrect.
I think morality is just a term we put on behavior. And then so you have to figure out how do you define your behavior? And I'm saying that behavior is defined by what's good for society. And you're saying,
right.
You're saying, well, somebody else might say it's about the earth. I don't know any groups that are like that. I don't know of anybody that says we should kill all humans because, it's an analogy you're bringing up, but it doesn't seem real world analogy.
It doesn't matter philosophically. And I would suggest that it's not that far out of the realm of possibility.
But the real world problem is Christians who say, oh, no, it's not about anything you might think about. It's all about what God tells you. You're not allowed to think about it. If God says do it, do it.
That's not what I'm saying either, because now you're talking about how you actually apply it. And I'm not saying it's just what God tells you. But
that's divine command theory.
But I'm talking about the philosophical foundation for ethics is when you try and say that, you know, society is the ultimate thing worthy of protection and promotion, you're making a massive assumption there that you're calling self-evident, but you have there's no way to prove that. There's no judge. No one to say you're right and this other person's wrong.
Right. I just say it's by definition. I think, I say, math is about numbers by definition. Morality is about the society.
That morality is about behavior, but what I'm disagreeing with you about is the presupposition that society is that thing that is the most deserving of protection and promotion.
Well, I don't see anybody advocating for anything else to compete with it in real life.
Well, yeah, of course you do. You see people who are more interested in themselves than society all the time. That's an exaltation of an individual over society.
But I don't think anybody's arguing that for morality.
It doesn't, well, people will argue all kinds of things, but it doesn't matter whether or not they actually argue it. We're talking about
I think the people in society do agree it's about the community, and if people are selfish, then they know, well, I'm doing something wrong, and I'm gonna see if I can get away with it. They know that's wrong because it goes against society.
Well, this is it's all pretty obviously circular reasoning to me, but that's fine. We can move on. I'm curious, okay, then, if I just assume that society is the thing most worthy of, you know, directing our behaviors towards, as a atheistic evolutionist, how do you overcome determinism?
I don't see how does that relate to it?
Well, even Provine acknowledges that there's no such thing as free will if evolution is true.
What does that have to do with anything, though?
Because unless there is something, the idea of free will is it transcends the natural law.
Yeah,
something
causes another,
and there's no ultimate deviation from that. There's no ought, there just is.
Right. Yeah, I know the free will and determinism is a big subject. Basically, if you say you don't have free will, then why even put anybody in prison? Because that's not really their fault, because they didn't have free will.
Because a lot of these things, no one's that foolish to live that out. But I think if you're being honest to the worldview of atheistic evolution, that's what you're left with.
Well,
that free will is just an illusion.
The reason why people say that things are determinate is because of physics, the advance of physics, how accurate it is, it could prescribe things. And they say, well, if you knew everything about everything, you could probably calculate everything in advance, even your thought processes. But then a counterpoint to that now is with quantum mechanics, where there's indeterminate states of, like, for example, the position of electron. They say it's indeterminate, and it's not known until the waveform collapses. So there's actual...
Well, I'm not talking about knowing things. I'm talking about the actual ability to break causality, to be able to break cause and effect. Because that's what you have to do for free will, right? You have to be able to say, I'm not just going to respond to this naturally. Yeah. I have a choice.
Well, actually, at the quantum level, they say cause and effect is broken, too. There's Richard Feynman one time said, you know, the philosophers hate this, but it's like, deal with it. That's nature. You don't understand it, but that's it.
Yeah. Well, I've heard stuff like that, too, but it's essentially what ends up happening is if you go to the quantum level like that and you start making claims like that, you're throwing logic out the window, and there's no, you can't even make that claim then because it starts self-refuting itself.
Yeah, but that's Feynman's point, is that, sorry, I'm sorry that you don't like it, that your logic has been busted there, but that's quantum mechanics. You know, that's what's going on at the quantum level, and the universe is bigger than our little brains sometimes.
Yeah, so what that's ultimately saying is we have no way of having any of these conversations because we really can't distinguish anything.
Well, we're not at the quantum level, so that doesn't really relate to morality so much.
Okay, so then it doesn't apply to the situation.
Mm-hmm, right.
So you still can't transcend determinism unless you're a quantum entity, I suppose.
I don't know. I'm not really. I think this thing about free will and determinism is a whole other subject. So,
but it's a huge problem for an atheistic evolutionist. That's a huge issue. If you're trying to, now it's not a problem if you're like Provine, and I would suggest more honest reality and the consequences.
Well, I've never heard anybody say. I've done a lot of Christian atheist debates, and I've never ever heard any Christian say like, this is a major problem we got to confront.
Well, they sure should be. How do you overcome that? If all that exists is the material and the natural laws, they're just playing out. They just are.
Yeah.
So how do, I mean, I can easily say from a, you know, and you'd probably call it God of the gaps, but I can say certainly if God exists, that it would make sense that he would be able to ascribe some kind of transcendent ability to make a choice. But without that, some external force inserting that in, it would, you're kind of left just, well, it's just an illusion that we have free will. And I think a lot of scientists say that. A lot of evolutionary scientists will acknowledge that. They just say, well, it's totally impractical, so I'm gonna act this way over here in my field of study, but then when I go home, I'm gonna protect my wife and kids like you know, I have the ability to and the choice to do certain things.
I don't know. I think there's a lot of absurdities in thinking things like God knows everything, because if he knows everything, it wouldn't make any sense to actually create anything. Why would he bother creating anything when he already knows in exact detail everything that's going to happen at every microsecond? It doesn't make any sense. And since he can't do anything, now he's totally bored to death because he already knows everything. I mean, if I was going to see a movie, it's entertaining to me because I've seen it. If I've seen it a million times, that would get sickening to me. But God knows it like a zillion, zillion, up to the zillion power times. He knows every second, every microsecond of what's going to happen.
I think that's a little off topic, don't you?
Well, I mean, it's just
morality.
Yeah. I mean, just talking about the absurdities of, like, determinism and all that, you're saying. Okay.
Oh. Well, yeah, I mean, then you're dealing with God's motives, and I'm certainly not qualified to tell God why he does things, but
okay.
I think that's a big issue, is you've got to get... I still struggle greatly with the idea that humans have worth and value. I mean, I used to do all kinds of immoral things because, I didn't really think that from a philosophical level people had worth and value. Now, inside, I would suggest now from my perspective that we all have that inborn within us as given by God. But really, on a naturalistic level, there's no way to really ascribe any kind of anything beyond some temporary utility to society or humans. But then you also have no free will. So the other question then is, what would your source of... I mean, because I assume you agree with some sort of exclusive morality, correct?
What do you mean by exclusive morality?
Well, the term that's more popularly used would be absolute.
Yeah.
But you're not...
Or objective.
Do you believe in relative morality?
Yeah, of course.
But even so,
the right moral thing to do is whatever would be less painful. So, for example, is raping a baby ever bad? Well, it could be a good thing to do if you have two choices and the alternative is worse. If your alternative is you have to rape a baby or nuke a city with 10 million people, which is the moral choice to make?
Right. So ultimately what you're doing there, though, is you're kind of changing the definition, and I wouldn't even call that relative morality. I would call that a very intricate application of morality.
Well, that's a moral question, though.
No, it is. But hear what I'm saying on this is that so when I look at true relative morality contradicts the law of non-contradiction. Because what happens then, you know, law of non-contradiction, nothing can both be and not be at the same time in the same respect.
Right.
What you're doing there is saying, what you're changing qualifiers on that statement, you know, is, which is why if you want to come up with an absolute moral thing, it's like, you know, they say something like it's never okay to torture a child for pleasure without, you know, any, you know, whatever, you know, they make these very specific claims. Because you can ultimately add qualifiers to any statement to get around whether or not something is moral, you know. But you're not actually positing a singular thing. You're talking about two completely different things, like raping a child for fun versus raping a child to save the rest of humanity. That's not a one for one. You know what I'm saying? You're taking a similarity, but then tacking on extra qualifiers to actually change it.
Well, I think all they're doing when they ask a question like that, like, you know, absolute morals exist. There's these laws that are always cannot be, they're just like written in heaven or something. And so, for example, they say raping a child for fun. What you're doing is you're picking something that is so obvious. So it's like, okay.
You have to.
I mean, it's, for example, it's like saying abortion is always wrong. Why? Well, if a baby has been in the womb for 9 months, is about ready to pop out, and you kill it, obviously that's abortion, that's murder, right? Well, of course it's murder. You're picking an obvious case where that's murder because it's a second before it's born. Obviously, probably almost everybody would say that's murder.
And a lot of people don't think that's murder.
What's that?
Well, I mean, even the example you just gave, you've got partial birth abortions, which, you know.
No, I'm talking about, like, yeah, but I'm talking about something even more. I'm just saying take an obvious position. An obvious position is one second before it's born, 9 months, it's totally ready to be viable and everything. And if you kill it then, of course, it's murder. And so they would say, therefore,
murder. Disagree with you there.
What's that?
A lot of people would disagree with you on that. I don't. I think you're dead on.
I don't think anybody would justify a woman carrying a baby all the way to 9 months. It's about ready to be born, and she decides to have an abortion. I think everybody, almost like 99.9%, would say that is murder.
Are you not familiar with partial birth abortions?
Yeah, but that's not 9 months, like I said.
Or what about Peter Singer? I mean, you know what he talks about and advocates for?
Okay.
The Princeton ethicist. He says, mm-hmm. you know, because ultimately the idea is that the child is not really viable until they're over a year old. So technically you should be able to kill a child at a year. And anyway, this is all kind of off topic, but...
Yeah.
I understand.
I understand what he's saying, and I think it's an interesting discussion. It's something to argue about. I think it's extreme. I would probably argue about it, but I think it's an interesting discussion to have.
But here's the problem with relative morality, and I think I agree with you on something, Bernie. That there is a tendency to oversimplify that Christians are certainly guilty of, and I would suggest atheists are as well. But there is a absolute morality. Oh, it's written in the Bible, and so that means it's law, and that's it. You know, that's end of story. I don't think the Bible even presents itself that clearly.
And one of the things that's really ridiculous, too, is like on abortion, like the Catholic stance is that any kind of birth control is bad. And, for example, if a woman uses the pill, that's abortion, that's bad. I mean, to me, that's ridiculous.
Well, are you familiar with the workmanship principle?
No.
Locke's workmanship principle. Essentially, it says that the creator, only a creator can ascribe value to its creation. That was John Locke. And it's in our Declaration of Independence, by the way, although slightly adjusted to accommodate for Bentham's utilitarianism. But they, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that certain, endowed by our creator, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So the idea there is that value and worth are ascribed by the creator, which is what I was trying to point to earlier. But what happens with because I've actually done a little bit of conversation on bioethics, and you get into some really hairy issues with that, because the question ultimately becomes, it's not whether or not it's life. I think any one of us would agree that A, it's human, and B, it's life, even in embryonic stages, right? The question is whether or not that life has value worthy of protection. And at what stage we are incapable of discerning the value difference between an embryo and a 9-month-old baby.
Okay, well...
It's arbitrary.
We really went a lot of overtime on this one.
Okay, sure. No
how
problem.
About if, okay, how about if we go on to the next one?
Yeah, that's fine.
And this one, we're only going to do 5 minutes because we're so far over time. This
okay.
is, can one feel the presence of God? The reason why I came up with this one is because William Lane Craig, for example, I'll just read you one paragraph here. I was going to read like 4 or 5 paragraphs, but I'll just read you two. This is from William Lane Craig. He's a very popular Christian debater. So this idea about feeling the presence of God, is this argument for the existence of God? He says, all right, first of all, it's very important to understand that the witness of the Holy Spirit is not just a subjective religious experience. This is an objective reality. It's a witness which God himself bears with our spirit. It is as objective as light rays impinging upon our retina and causing you to see something. This is an objective work and activity of God on the spirit. So this isn't just some sort of subjective religious experience that arises from your own emotions and feelings. Having said that, that does not mean that the witness of the Holy Spirit serves as objective evidence for the Christian faith, as the reader seems to think. This is misunderstanding of what one is talking about here. The witness of the Holy Spirit is not construed as evidence from which you then infer that God exists, as though one infers from this experience that the best explanation of this experience is that there really is a God. There are arguments like that from religious experience, but this is not an argument from religious experience. In fact, it is not an argument at all. It is a claim that you can know that God exists and that Christianity is true wholly apart from arguments simply through the inner testimony of God to your heart. So don't think of this as an argument from religious experience. Rather, it is the claim that for the person to whom God bears witness by means of the spiritual testimony, such a person can know with confidence that Christianity is true because of the witness that God bears to him. Then just a couple more sentences says, now he asks, how can this be self-authenticating? Well, I don't think that it's hard to understand. An experience can be so powerful, so enlightening, that it simply bears its own credentials. Like in the movie Contact, where the figure played by Jodie Foster has the experience at the climax of the movie by seeing the secret of the mystery of the universe and then all of its majesty and beauty, and she says, I never knew, I never knew. And then she tries to relate the experience to others and they are skeptical about it. She can't prove what really happened. So, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I was an evangelical born-again Christian. I believe that I felt like I was led by God. I felt like I had a relationship with God. And I now believe it's a delusion, the God delusion. I don't think it's real because I don't believe God exists. So what would you have to say about this? And we only have about 3 minutes left. I'll let you talk about this.
Okay. Well, I think, let me just say, I don't agree that a singular experience is generally a sufficient basis for adopting a complete belief system or worldview. With that said, I tend to take epistemologically, I take the stance on any religious experience as simply a piece of empirical evidence, being something that's known as experience, through our senses. And so I don't necessarily elevate that evidence to a higher level. I would just suggest that if I have a religious experience, that in some sense that experience actually occurred, and so I have to do my best to interpret that data, more or less. Mm-hmm.
Well, like I said in another broadcast, I studied with some Mormons once, and they said to pray about the Book of Mormon. I did, and I got the feeling, but then I didn't become a Mormon because of what I knew. I knew it was nonsense.
All right, so I'd say your methodology is consistent with mine to some extent in that you took that experience and you processed it as a piece of data within the broader context of more data, and you came to the determination that it was a false experience.
But it's a real experience. It's something I really felt. I had to disallow it. I had to say, like, in the court of my mind, that is not allowed because it doesn't.
Right. So I misspoke, actually. Not a false experience. That's not the best way to say that. It was not, the source of that experience was not what it was purported to be. Is that fair?
No, I think it was a valid. Who knows what the source is? I mean, the source of your experience could be invalid too. I don't know about the source. I think the brain, it's some kind of a trick where the brain manufactured it. So, to me, I got, on one hand, I have an experience. On the other hand, I've got knowledge, and I had to say these are conflicting, but I have to go with the knowledge. There's no way I could throw away the knowledge based on the experience. What's that?
But your knowledge is made up of other experiences.
The knowledge is based on logic and facts, not experiences.
Well, but the fact of the matter is you had that experience. I mean, epistemologically, a posteriori knowledge is empirical evidence based on some kind of sense experience. Right?
Now, No, I would say it's based on logic, like deduction and induction.
That would be a priori.
But it's not feelings. It's not feelings at all. It's the logic and feelings are two. To me, they're two different things. They're at odds.
Do you understand the difference between non-empirical and empirical data, though? Like, there's pure reason, and then there's the ability to experience things, and that can be experiencing that one apple plus one apple equals two apples. You can experience that, but there's a difference between that and pure reason.
No, but I wouldn't say that's really, I wouldn't call that an experience. I mean, that's not a feeling kind of thing to say there's one apple plus one apple. I mean, that's an observation, not a feeling.
But you're using your senses to experience that. You're using your sight instead of your sensation of touch.
Right. Yeah, but you're not going by your feelings where you say, I know this is true because I feel it in my heart. I mean, that's the totally different thing.
But that's not what you felt either. You felt a sensory experience, correct?
I felt the touch of God.
In reading the Book of Mormon.
The Mormons would say, hey, that was God. He spoke to you just like he spoke to us. We all have that burning in the bosom. That's it. Amen. And it's like, I can't accept that because I got the feeling, but I just can't accept that it's valid because it doesn't make sense. They might say, like, well, it doesn't have to make sense. Just go with your feelings. And I would say, no, sorry. I'm going with the I'm going with what makes logical sense, not what I can't go with the feelings.
And what I'm saying is, I think we're looking at this probably closer than you realize it. And so far as what I'm saying is, well, you may be totally discounting that experience. I would suggest that experience should be considered within the picture of larger amounts of data, which is what you ended up doing, was you looked at, I have all of this information, and I have new information. The new information is I had this experience. Mm-hmm. This new information contradicts this other information, so I'm going to interpret this experience, this new information of experience, through the lens of this other data I have, which I would say is the correct thing to do. I think you did the right thing there. But the only thing I think we would differ on maybe is I would not maybe just as so quickly disregard that experience. I might suggest that, I'd say there's two possibilities from that. One is some kind of, I don't know, hyper placebo effect. Where you just had this, something like that occur on maybe on more of a naturalistic perspective. Or I could say maybe you had a really genuine religious experience with that, and I can say that as a Christian, and that doesn't contradict, my belief system, that you could still have a genuine experience there.
Okay, well, so we're way over time and we're out of time. We're going to get kicked out of the studio soon. I'll give you 30 seconds to summarize the whole program, and then we'll say goodbye. And I appreciate you coming on here.
Well, thanks, Bernie. I appreciate it.
Okay. So why don't maybe give a little summary over everything.
Okay. Well, so as far as both Adam or both the Genesis 1 and the Noah accounts, I guess my main point is that if you're considering believing in God, you don't have to take those as historic to accept Christ or God. But that there is still evidence for those things, and there's a wide breadth, kind of a sliding scale of interpretations on those things that if you're interested in the particulars of, there's good resources for. And I would encourage people to seek out evidences from or perspectives across the board and interpret all of the possibilities and really try and take a open mind to that. Morally, I would suggest that without God, we've seen that there's no way to ascribe any kind of transcendent worth or value. All we can look at is temporal utility. There's no free will without God. The free will is transcendent. You don't have choice. And we didn't really get into this, but I'd even go so far as to say that there's no purpose to suffering and no hope beyond the inconsistent existence that we experience. So there's quite a bit of evidence for God. We didn't even get into the cosmology and things like that, which are very interesting discussions.
Yeah.
But in any case, I guess I'll just leave it at that.
Okay. Chris, thanks again for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. And I hope you enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. So.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Barney. I appreciate it.
Okay. We'll talk to you later.
Okay. Take care.
Bye.